waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine now, let it shine now. Burning bright, cause we're not ashamed. Got a world to illuminate. You're the light, let it shine now, let it shine now.
On a series on the subject of faith, and I thought maybe we'd be done last Sunday, but I just wasn't satisfied. Tried to move on to the next thing that I have in my heart to minister, and it just I felt like we just had to linger with this a little bit longer, especially what I want to talk about again today from last week. Remember the sermon last Sunday? I speak, I believe, and therefore I speak. I want to take that on today because it just wasn't satisfied with the extent that I got to, because there's just so much in Scripture about this. And I think if we can get this church to be what I'm just going to call a prophetic church. Prophetic meaning we're saying stuff. And because we're saying things based on the truth of God's word, tomorrow is different. People's lives are different. Next year is different. The future is different because this church is a prophetic church, has God's word in its mouth, in our mouth, and we believe and therefore we speak. So let's say it together. I believe, therefore I speak. On the heels of that message from last Sunday, which you should listen to over and over again online, and on the heels of that, I want to do a message today called Speak It or Talk It Up. Talk It Up. Now, Pastor Jennifer and I, we're kind of raised in the South, so there are colloquial expressions that, you know, you have. I don't know if you use this or not. You probably do just like we do. But, you know, when somebody talks a lot and they really talk about something they're excited about, and they may even exaggerate. Have you ever heard somebody, I mean, they talk about their golf game. If I talk about my golf game, I'm not going to tell you about the worst part of it. I'm going to talk it up. You know, I'm going to tell you about the good stuff, and I may exaggerate just a little bit, you know, and sorry, but, you know, and so you hear somebody talk like that about something they're really passionate about or excited, and you walk away, and you might look at your spouse or somebody you're with and go, boy, they can really talk it up, can't they? You all ever hear that expression, talk it up? So it may mean that, you know, somebody just talks a lot, but it also may mean in combination with that they really kind of embellish, or they just really kind of talk about that subject or what they're passionate about, and you're like, I'm not even sure if all of that's true, but boy, they can really talk it up. And you admire their passion. Well, when it comes to a believer, when it comes to believing God's word, we're not going to exaggerate. We're going to tell the truth. We're going to talk it up. We're going to talk a lot because we need to be talking the truth of God's word. And then talking his word is talking it up. Come on, there's enough talk putting things down. We need some people talking it up. We need some people talking about what God is doing and what God wants to do. There's enough talk about what's going on and bringing people down. We need to talk people up. So our words should bring things up. Talk it up. So look at your neighbor and tell them this is how you're supposed to do it. Talk it up. That means two things. Talk a lot. And a lot of folks are saying amen to that one. We should be talking a lot. And I'll show you from Scripture today. And secondly, we should be talking it up. Man, when people hear you talk, their hearts ought to be lifted up. Their vision ought to go up. Their dreams ought to go up. Their strength ought to go up. That's enough to bring us down. We need things that keep us and protect us against the draining force of this world. We need the kingdom stuff, prayer, the word, speaking the word, prophecy. We need things that bring people and things up, not bring them down. Come on, talk it up. I like that, don't you? All right, let's go through the scripture. I used this last Sunday, James chapter 3, verse 10. I hope you make good notes and maybe listen to this sermon again and again once it's posted online tomorrow. But in James chapter 3, verse 10, James the apostle, talking about our words in our mouth in that mostly entire chapter about it, says this: out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. Now, like I said last Sunday, he wouldn't say this if it weren't real. It wouldn't be empty words in Scripture. Apparently, we can bless and we can curse with our mouth. Has anybody heard those things? Has anybody done those things? Aren't you glad for the grace of Jesus? I'm really glad for the grace of Jesus. But cursing and blessing is real. I just want you to see this. And today is going to bless you so much, because we're going to speak words of blessing and help us understand how to speak them. If we can bless or curse, James goes on to say there, it shouldn't be that out of the same well comes bitter water and sweet water. As a believer, that means I'm one who trusts Jesus and I believe his word. I ought to be one who just wants sweet water to come out of this well. Out of my belly, out of my heart, Jesus said, flow rivers of living water. Living water doesn't sound like curse, does it? Sounds like blessing. Dispensers of God's grace and God's blessing. And then we're in the book of James, so let's go back a chapter and look at James chapter 1 there, verse 26. James chapter 1, verse 26, and here's what it says. I'll give you a moment to turn there if you want to see it in your own Bible. James 1, 26, it says, if anybody thinks he's religious and doesn't bridle his tongue but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. This is a powerful verse with a lot of truth in it. The piece we want to just kind of emphasize right now is if you think you're religious and it doesn't bridle your tongue. Bridle means there's control. He says here in James 3, it's like a bit in a horse's mouth. You can turn the horse wherever you want it to go because of the bit in its mouth, and that's how our tongue is in our being. Here he says, look, if you say you're religious, and that term isn't used often in Scripture, but if you say you're religious and it doesn't change your tongue, your religion is not doing you any good. That's what it's saying. We could literally say like this, maybe a little simpler for you to get. If a person's religion doesn't lead their tongue, their religion's doing them no good. God meant for it to be this way, that what we believe, its first expression is with our tongue, with our words. Believe in the heart, confess with the mouth. Right? That's, I can't stop here and hang with these. I got too much to share this morning, so we just got to keep going. Next verse is Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. I'm sure you know this verse well. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Oh, death and life are in the power of the tongue. I don't need to explain that, do I? That's pretty self-explanatory. I'm just showing you at this moment, just showing you what Scripture says about the power of the tongue and what we do with our words. We are speaking beings. We're created that way. And at Romans chapter 10, verse 6 and 8. Romans chapter 10, verse 6 and 8. This is about the word of faith being in our mouth. Being in our mouth. Let's read this little portion of Scripture. But the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above? Who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead? But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. If you're wondering what all that is trying to say, it's simply saying this. People want to look outside somewhere, up to heaven, down somewhere. Let's like get Christ to come. Let's get it from out there somewhere. Go to heaven and get Christ here. Go down and bring Christ here. Like always looking otherworldly. Like someday we can get him to. Someday we can have it come. Someday we can enjoy his benefits. We got to go somewhere and get him here. And the word of faith, new covenant, this time of faith now. Says you don't have to go anywhere. It's as close as your mouth. You don't have to go somewhere for a healing. You don't have to go somewhere for your comfort. You don't have to go somewhere for your strength. The word is as close as your mouth. The promises are right here. Put it in your mouth. What Christ has accomplished is as close as you are. Don't have to go somewhere. It's as close as your mouth. Oh, it's God's original design. Let's step back a little bit now to how God functions, and then I'll come around to where we want to finish up today. But it's God's MO. It's his mode of operation. He speaks. He speaks. You know this. You could preach it yourself. Genesis chapter 1 and the creation story. And if we're going to read verse 2 and 3, I just want to read it. I want you to see it again. I use this often. Look at it here. The earth was without form, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of the Lord was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. The earth, back up to verse 2 there. Look at it here. The earth was without form and void. That word void means empty. The earth was without form, was void, it was empty. And God's answer to the emptiness. Whew. I'm afraid I'm going to get ahead of myself, and I can't do that. And God spoke, his answer to the emptiness was, fill the void with words. Because what's needed to fill the emptiness will respond to the words I fill the void with, and the void will be filled because I put words in there, and the creative power of God brings to pass the words that have been given and filled that emptiness. And so this is the operation of God. Look at it throughout Scripture. It's confirmed everywhere. Hebrews 11, verse 3. Hebrews 11, verse 3. It says, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. We understand that the worlds were framed by God's word. We know the creation story, that it was framed. This is created by the word. This is the MO of everything we're on. The vegetation you see outside and what you enjoyed this morning, the sunrise as the sun came up, it's all because God spoke into an empty place with words. And words frame. So let's use the word frame. I love that they translated it that way. It could have translated created, but I like the word frame because they tried to capture the original language best as they could. And so the word frame means if you frame something, everything inside of the frame is within the frame. You look at some of these drawings or paintings on the wall here. You can't go, there's that picture's outside of the frame. Everything that's inside of creation is in the frame of His Word. Come on, so everything is inside the frame of His Word. And then I started at a very young age as a teenager as a builder and built houses and did construction and those kind of things. And so I understand also framing. That framing also, the framing of a house is what everything else hangs on. Without a frame, you don't have paint that'll stay on the walls. Without a frame, the pictures won't hang on the walls. There won't be walls. The frame is what everything else, or let's say it like this, the frame is what supports everything else. And He framed the world. And He put everything on the support of His Word. That's why it's a sure thing, because His Word is settled forever in heaven. Amen. This is the MO of God. This is how God operates. He calls those things that be not as though they were. We're in a sound world. We're in a frequency world. God has created with His Word. God's Word is what upholds the stuff. The grass is green outside because God spoke. The rain comes, the waters the earth, there's water, there's life, there's you whatever you want to name, go to the creation story. It's because God spoke. That's how He made this thing. That's how He operates. Hebrews verse 1, chapter 1, verse 3. Oh. We could get this, and we will get this in our hearts. Shining light in you, we are a prophetic voice. That's nothing spooky or anything. It just means God's word is in us, and we use it to change stuff. The world is different because His word is in our mouth. Who being the brightness of His glory, this is Jesus, and the express image of His person, and upholding all things by the word of His power. How much is upheld by the word of His power? All things. That's why you want to find His word for you, because He'll uphold you with His word. We're born again by His word. We're kept by His word. We're blessed by His word. We shall know the truth and it'll set you free. We're set free by His word. Psalm 33 verse 6. Psalm 33 verse 6. He sums it up so well. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and all the host of them by the breath of His mouth. Do you see this? This is the operation of God. This is the creation we live on. This is us. He created man. You can read this, and maybe I just need to do a series on speaking and just take this on because there's so much. When God made man, and when he made the things that it, Genesis 1 records, but especially man, here's what it says. It says, God made them, and he blessed them, saying. Come on. That's how he made us. He would make. He would create with his words. And then it says about several things. You have the fish of the sea and some things. It says about that. But especially about man. He says he made man. Let us make man in our image. And it says he made them, formed them, and then he blessed them. Saying. The next word after he blessed them is saying, and then scripture records what he says. Be fruitful and multiply. Have dominion on the earth. If he spoke that back then, it's still going today. We lost a lot of that through sin and through the fall of man, but Jesus restored it all, and those words are still true today. He gave man dominion on the earth and gave us a place. That blessing is on us today. The blessing comes from words. Scripture's clear that when God blesses, he speaks. And he blessed them. Oh. You know, there are lots of examples we could point to. But there's two that I'll point to in Scripture. In Numbers 13 and Numbers 14, you can read this story later. It's the story of the children of Israel who had come out of Egypt. They're on the brink of going in to take the land God had promised to them. And you know the story. Spies were sent in there. There was, in other words, scouts were sent in to see what it's like. They came back, and there were a number of them who gave a bad report. And it says it was an evil report. An evil report. And if you look at it, they actually pretty much just told the truth. They pretty much just told how it was. As you know, talking about how it is an evil report. If it's different than what God promised. Because there were a number of them who came back, gave, really just said what they saw. Walled cities, giants, all of that. And the whole crowd of Israel, the whole congregation, it says, started mourning and crying and complaining. And by the way, one of the big symptoms of unbelief and not believing God is complaining. Well, if you find yourself complaining, you might as well go, unbelief. I need to get in the Word and get faith going in my life again. Because how can you believe His promises and complain? The two just aren't compatible. Oops, sorry, I had to go there. Amen. And so they're complaining and they're discouraged and all that. But there are two who stand up, Caleb and Joshua. They stand up, and the scripture says they had a different spirit. Look at it here in Numbers 14, verse 8, I guess it is. Numbers 14, verse 8. It says, if the Lord delights in us, he'll bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. In other words, don't look at the obstacles. Don't look at how it looks like it is. Take the promises of God and let's say we are well able to take the land. A little earlier, Caleb stilled the people and said, come on, let's go up at once and take the land. That's the kind of spirit of faith that needs to be speaking. Let's take the land. Let's do what God promised. Let's do great things for God because He's with us and we are well able. There's enough talk about how things are, What this world needs is people who will talk about how they will be and can be, because our God is with us and he has given us promises. And so the second story, and oh, by the way, if you read that story, it is kind of depressing, because further down, God says, I heard them talk, and they're going to get exactly what they talked about. It's not a really good story, because then they started wandering in the wilderness. They could have went in that next day, taken their promised land, because it was as close as their mouth. But they decided to talk and complain, and God, and they said stuff like, I wish we'd just die in the wilderness. God said, you're going to die in the wilderness. That's what he said. The difference was their mouth, not what God wanted for them. It was their mouth. Blessing, cursing, life, death. The next one, you know the story of David and Goliath, don't you? Kills a big Goliath, the giant, with a stone and a slingshot, goes up against him. You know the story. If you want to read it, it's in 1 Samuel chapter 17. You can read the whole story. The army of Israel was afraid and were conquered down, and they were so afraid because this giant was threatening them. And then here comes David to bring lunch for his brothers. And he's... This is how faith works, man. People with something in their heart from God, you know. And he looks at this whole situation and goes, what's going on? God's soldiers in foxholes, a big guy up there threatening with a voice, and they're all shivering in fear. What's going on? And he says, let me go up and fight him. And I won't embellish the story, because it's just such a great story. But you know it. He goes through the process of putting Saul's armor on. Goes, I can't do that. It's not man's might that's going to do this. It's what God tells me to do. Let me get 5 smooth stones, put them in my pocket, and take my slingshot that I'm used to using, and I'm going to go up there. And he walks up there in his shepherd's clothes with a little slingshot and stone. He pulls those out, puts one in. But as he's going toward the battle, come on, this is how we fight our battles. As he's going toward the battle, his mouth isn't silent. He's talking as he's going. Is there not a cause? Yeah, you come to me with a sword and you come to me with all that armor, but I come to you in the name of the Lord, and my God is going to give me the victory today. I'm going to defeat that spirit of fear. I'm going to defeat that voice of fear against this army. I'm walking up there because my God is with me. I have a covenant with God, and he's uncircumcised, which means he doesn't have a covenant. He's not in God's army. I'm in God's army. It doesn't matter how outsized I am. I'm going to win because God is with me, and I'm coming to him not with some big armor in the natural, but I'm coming in the name of the Lord. He's talking it up. He's walking up the hill toward that giant, and he's talking it up as he's going, talking about the promises of God and how God will give us the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, you might get a bad report from a doctor, but quit talking that report up. Start talking about what God has done. Jesus died on the cross. Jesus took wounds. He shed his blood for my healing and my strength. Look what God's going to do. What I have to overcome is just a testimony of the healing virtue and glory of God that Jesus provided for me. Do more research. Do more research on what Jesus has done than on your disease. Come on, talk it up. We can talk. I want to finish today with this challenge. When God wanted to fill the void where there was emptiness, he spoke. I'm asking the members of Shining Light, this believing body, to become speaking people into the voids of life. Wherever there's a void, come on, silence leaves voids. Silence makes people wonder. Silence makes people wonder where the relationship stands. Silence makes insecurities rise. If we can speak into the void, why would we let things be empty when we can speak and fill the void? Huh? Why wouldn't we speak and prophesy into the void of silence and into the void of emptiness? Prophesy and speak the word of faith. That means we speak what we believe. It's a word of faith. We walk not by what we see, but by what we believe. We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. Our words are because of what we believe, not because of what it looks like. Blessing. Let me give you this little list of things. I got to give you some homework. Shouldn't we be speaking life? Jesus is our life. So what we should be speaking is anything that matches him. I'm as righteous as Jesus. I'm as blessed as Jesus today. Not because of what I've done, but because of what he's done. He's my life. I speak life. Speak life. Speak life into the void. What's the void of that's not life? The void is death. And we know everything is going that way. Death and sin has done its thing, and death is trying to knock it at the door of just everything on this planet. But the antidote to that is God's life through Christ as words in our mouth. Speak life. Speak life. Speak blessing. Speak blessing. That means to bless people. And in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, I already quoted it. Here it is. God blessed them and said to them. I won't read the rest of the verse, but that when he blessed them, he spoke. What would happen if we started blessing people? Jacob and Esau looked for the blessing of their father until Esau sold his birthright and then later repented because he realized, oh, those patriarchs, those stories in the scripture, they tell us the power of blessing. Look, Jacob and Esau had an inheritance from their father. They had stuff. Stuff will never take the place of verbal blessing. Come on, I appeal to you fathers. Open your mouth and bless your children. Don't think, well, they get my stuff. I'm working hard to provide for them. Give them the thing their void is longing for, and that's verbal blessing. They'll sell their birthright to get your blessing. They'd give up everything you'd ever give them if they had your blessing. I promise you. Speak into the void. Because where there's silence, there's insecurity. Where there's silence, there's fear. Where there's silence, there's a wondering. Where there's silence, there's a void. But you ought to be filling that void with blessing over your family, over your children, over everybody. Come on, we ought to be filling the void with the blessing of God coming out of our life. You can do this. You are blessed to do great things. You're going to fulfill the destiny of your life. You're going to do what God has put in your heart. Whatever you were born for, you're going to fulfill it. Bless them, bless them, bless them. In the void of blessing is curse. Oh boy, I tell you, in the void. See, the thing about how this is made and how this functions is the void is not just when people are speaking curse. Silence lets the curse. You got to do something about it. That's how it works. In silence, it stays dark. We got to change it with our words. And blessing and How about encouragement? How about encouragement? How many dreams and how many visions and how many things in people's hearts die because nobody encourages somebody? What's the void of encouragement? Discouragement. It takes courage to do stuff in life. I don't want to be the person that discourages somebody. I want to be the person that encourages them. And it's words that encourage people. People are like, well, they know we're with them. No, you don't. Words are powerful. Yes. Well, my family knows I'm always there. Talk to them. My church knows I'm always there for them. No, they don't. Talk to them. My fellow members, my neighbors, they know we're always here. No, they don't. In the void of words, fear runs rampant. Insecurity runs rampant. Words are meant to fill this void. He feeds us with His word daily. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. It's His word that feeds us. It's His word that strengthens us. It's His word that encourages us. It's His word that fills the void. Come on, let's fill this planet with the word of God. Let's fill people's hearts with the word and bless them, encourage them. And the final one is edify them, build them up. Let your words be seasoned with grace that only it edifies. I gave you the scripture last Sunday. You can look it up. That the only thing that comes out of your mouth edifies people. Edify means build them up. Come on, there's enough being torn down. We ought to be building people up, building them up. Man, I come out of our presence and go, I can do what God put in my heart. I thought I was going to give up, but I'm encouraged now and we're going for it. Somebody's ready to step away from their dream and they get around us and they go, oh, man, with God, all things are possible. Let's get on the train. Let's get this thing going. A dream lied dormant for 20 years. I'm ready to revive it. I got around those shining light people and they edified me. And it doesn't happen in silence. It happens in the flow of words. Fill the void with words of faith. Speak life, bless, encourage, build people up. And we can sum it up in this word, prophesy. Prophesy. That means tomorrow be different. People will do things tomorrow because we spoke today. There'll be strength in somebody to overcome a battle tomorrow because of what you said to them today. They'll make decisions based on the wisdom of God because you told them they could today. Tomorrow will be different. That's prophecy. That's edifying people. Prophecy builds people up and says, you can do it. And here's what God says about it. You might be facing this, but let me tell you what God's going to help us do. We prophesy. Talk it up. There's people waiting for your blessing. People waiting for your encouragement. People waiting for your edification. Let's not leave this life leaving a void. I personally want to leave this life when it's my time to go, or when I want to go. That when I leave this life, I want to go, I filled the place up. When people got around me, I filled up their cup of blessing. Their cup of courage because of the words I spoke. God forbid in my weakness that I would ever do something or say something to somebody and they go, man, he discouraged me. Who would want that? Happens all the time. But not with shining light, folks. We believe and therefore speak. Come on, with every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, this is how you made us, to believe, to exercise that belief with our words. There are families that will absolutely be transformed if they'll be humble enough to implement this message. To fill their house with words of faith. marriages that will absolutely be transformed. But speak it according to what we believe. Children, young people, that will absolutely go for the stars because we believe and therefore speak. The world will be a different place because we believe and therefore speak. Hallelujah. But the first place of confession, that means speaking, is the place of saying yes to Jesus. Yes to his lordship. I believe and therefore speak. I believe with my heart that Jesus Christ, he is my Savior, my Lord. And I call on his name and I am saved. Thank you, God. Come on, will you put all your faith and trust in Jesus for your life and eternity? Will you go all in with him? Say yes to him. The next step is to be baptized. All in. Come on, he went all in for you. Let's go all in with him. He'll fill you with his Holy Spirit. Put his gifts in you. Put his virtues in you. Make you as clean as he is. Give you his life. Give you his right standing. Give you his sonship. It's too good to be true. But it's true. It's true. Will you say yes? Would you slip your hand up and say, yeah, that's me. Come on, let's all testify. Let's just all put our hands up. For the benefit of those who need to do it, maybe for the first time or just as a new revelation. But just let's all slip our hand up and just, Jesus, I confess. That means I speak. That you are my Savior. You are my Lord. And I put all my faith, all my trust in you for my life and eternity. Thank you for saving me in Jesus' name. I'm all in. I'm all in. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Still with heads bowed and eyes closed. If you say, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit today, this is your moment just to say, God, I believe that promise. I receive what you promised for me. You can just slip your hand up, say, yeah, I believe that. I receive it. I'm going to thank you every day from now on that I'm filled with your Holy Spirit. I receive it now the way you promised in Jesus' name. And then the last thing, as we get ready to sing and close this service, any need in your life, go ahead and receive from him this morning. I'm telling you, sicknesses are leaving here today and things are changing in your life. Answers will be here this week. And I just want to take this moment now and speak these things over you. You have life. The life of Christ. You are blessed, just as blessed as Jesus. You are full of courage and encouraged. Weakness and discouragement has to leave. I speak courage and strength over you in Jesus' name. And I build you up with the Word of God. With the Word of God. Build you up and say you are able, you are filled, you are strong. The anointing of God is on you. His words are in your mouth. You'll fulfill the destiny of your life. You'll do what God has called you to do. You'll be strong in doing it. You'll be able. You'll be blessed. The weakness will go. The strength is here. The blessing is on you. You're blessed, blessed, blessed. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's stand together.